Okay, so welcome to calculus. Now we're in section 10.1. It is differential equations, so really probably separable differential equations. Okay, so several weeks ago, we solved an exercise just like this. So given that the derivative of f is 4x minus 5, and f evaluated at 3 is 10, find f. Okay, so how did we solve this? Right. So f of x should be the antiderivative of the derivative of f of x. So that would be antiderivative 4x minus 5. So what is the antiderivative of 4x minus 5?
2x squared minus 5x.
Very good. And then plus some arbitrary constant. So have we answered the exercise?
No.
No, right? In what sense have we not answered the exercise?
Yeah, we don't.
Yeah, so we only know what f is up to some constant. And so now how do we identify that constant?
We can make that equal to 10.
Right, yeah. We'll use this information. When you plug in 3 for x, your 10 is supposed to come out, right? So 10 is 2 multiplied by 3 squared minus 5 multiplied by 3 plus c. And now it's just arithmetic. So that'd be 18 minus 15. 18 minus 15 is 3. Move it to the other side. 7 is c. So, the answer is 2x squared minus 5x plus 7. Okay, so we did something just like this a number of weeks ago. Any question about this one? Okay, so now we're going to do something pretty similar to that. So I'll say that dy dx is 4x minus 5, and 3/10, let's write it like this, and xy equal to 3/10. A solution. Find y. So now this is the first time I've ever written an exercise for you in this style, so I'm going to solve it for you. So then dy dx is 4x minus 5, so the derivative of y with respect to x. Well, that means differential dy is 4x minus 5 dx. This is sort of straddling the
plane.
Yeah, both of them. Okay, so then now from here, you can write, you can solve with the antiderivative. So antiderivative dy is antiderivative 4x minus 5 dx. So what is antiderivative dy? Just y. And what is antiderivative of 4x minus 5?
2x.
Yes, so 2x squared minus 5x, and then plus c. So we could have put the arbitrary constant on the other side, or we could have put two different arbitrary constants on each side. But because all the constants are arbitrary, you can just collect them all right here in this one position, because you could have moved this one over here or whatever. So now, have we determined y? No. How do we determine y? Yeah, by taking this information and plugging it in here. So, 10 is 2 times 3 squared minus 5 times 3 plus c, so 10 is 18 minus 15 plus c, so 7 is c. And therefore y is 2x squared minus 5x plus 7. Okay, so then now, I hope that you recognize that this was exactly the same exercise as the previous page. Okay, just written in a different style. Okay, now what we're going to do for the rest of today is we're going to run with this style and sort of see how far it goes. Okay? So for example, let P be a population which satisfies dp dt is 20 exponential 0.05 t and that the initial population is, say, 40. So find P. Okay. So what do we do? Right, good. So dp is, yeah, it's a,
what?
So does it seem like exactly the same exercise?
Yes.
Yeah, it is, right? It's just the numerical expressions are slightly different, right? So antiderivative dp, it'll get more interesting, I promise.
It's okay, yeah, we're good.
Okay, antiderivative of dp is p. And then that 20 just hangs out. What's antiderivative of exponential 0.05 t?
1 over 0.05.
Okay, good. What? 0.01?
No, 1 over, isn't it?
I think you're saying it. So 0.05 t.
Over 0.05.
Right. Okay, I think, yeah. And then plus C. Okay, so then P is, so division by, so 0.05 is 1 over 20. So division by 1 over 20 is same as multiplication by 20. So this would be 400 exponential 0.05 t, and then plus C. So have we answered the question?
No.
No. So how do we answer the question? P is 40 when what?
When 400 e to the 0.05 t plus c.
No.
T equals 0.
When t is 0, right? So initial population, understand that the meaning of that, that's saying that t0 or tp equal to 0.40 is a solution. That's the meaning of that language. So now what that means is that if you plug in t is 0 and p is 40, then that must be a solution. So now we'll take this, plug it into there. So 40 is 400 exponential of 0 plus c. What is exponential of 0?
1.
So negative 360 is c. So as a result, p is... what? 400 exponential 0.05 t minus 360. Any question about this one? Okay. So now let's make it more interesting. So given, so we've used variables x and y, variables t and p. What do you want to use now?
X and y.
X and y? Well, let's branch out a little bit.
A and B.
So given db da minus 2a is equal to 2a divided by square root a squared plus 3, and that ab equal to 1/8 is a solution. Solution. Find B.
Oh, that's interesting. I don't really think I like this one.
Okay. That word says solution. Okay, so what do we need to do? Okay, move the 2A over. So I think I take that to mean that DB over DA is 2A plus 2A divided by square root A squared plus 3. Okay, so why did you suggest that? Right, after I do the DA thing, right? Okay, so DB is 2A plus 2A divided by square root A squared plus 3 DA. And so now, what two variables are we talking about in this exercise? A and B. Now, I'd like to point out that what has been accomplished here is what variables are on the left-hand side?
A.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry, yes.
On the right-hand
side? On the right-hand side is A, on the left-hand side is B.
Right. Do you observe that the variables are separated according to their sides? Right. So only B is on the left, only A is on the right. So the variables are separated now. Okay, yes, now that we've gotten to this position, now it's just like the ones we did before. So we just anti-differentiate. Okay, so derivative DB, antiderivative 2A plus 2A over square root A squared plus 3 DA. So antiderivative DB, that's straightforward, that's B. How about, what's the antiderivative of this term? A squared. And then now this other stuff is too interesting to do all at once. Take further consideration. However, we've anti-differentiated two terms. Why have I not written the arbitrary constants? Yeah, because we have further antiderivatives to compute. Okay, so as for the remaining antiderivative, how will we proceed?
U
substitution. So what do you want to do for U?
A squared plus 3.
Okay, good.
What else?
So A squared plus 3, then what's DU?
2A.
Oh, that's really convenient, because that's what we have. So then B is A squared plus antiderivative 1 over square root U DU. So this antiderivative, that's log of square root of U, right?
No.
No. However, some students are still writing that. Okay, so to get, it does look like a little bit, at least visually, superficially, it does look like the log one, right? Because the log one is 1 over u du. But this is not 1 over u du, this is 1 over square root u. So it's not the log one. So how do we proceed with this? So what do you mean make it negative? Negative half,
yeah.
Right? Good. So this would be B is A squared plus antiderivative u to negative half exponent du. And now that we have it written in this way, you can see what? What rule will we actually use? The power rule, good. So b is a squared plus, so we'll add 1 to negative half, that's half. Okay, then we'll divide by half, but dividing by half is the same as multiply by 2. So this is 2 square root u plus c. Now we need to resubstitute.
Is it not negative
2? It's not, because negative half plus 1
is
positive half. Okay, so surely we've answered the exercise now.
No.
No. Right. What remains? Right. This remains. So we're supposed to get 8 for B when we plug in 1 for A. So that'd be 1 plus 2 times square root 4 plus c. Well, square root of 4 is 2 times 2 is 4 plus 1 is 5. So 3 is c. And therefore, the answer to the question is b is a squared plus 2 square root a squared plus 3 plus 3 plus 3, and then somehow I wrote c. It's 3. Any question about this one? Exciting. Okay, so now all of these ones, I could have given you this. I could have phrased this one differently and given it to you 3 weeks ago. I could have phrased it differently. So now we want to start getting to some ones that are new to us that I could not have phrased 3 weeks ago. Okay, something that's entirely new. Okay, so then here's an example of one that's entirely new to us. So how about given y dy dx is x squared, find the general solution. So the general solution means the meaning of that language means up to the plus c. So that means that when you get to the plus c part, you're finished. There's no further place to go. What do you think? Okay. If we were to do that, then we would have y dy is x squared dx.
And you should divide both sides by y.
But that won't work.
Did you just take the antiderivative of both sides?
Now you just do both sides. So antiderivative of left-hand side is antiderivative of right-hand side. So what is the antiderivative of y dy?
Not y squared over 2.
Yes. And antiderivative of x squared? Dx?
x cubed over 3.
And then plus a constant. So this one we couldn't have done. I couldn't have phrased it in that previous language where I said derivative of f is whatever. I couldn't have done it like that. Because formerly, all of the ones that we solved were, when we got to this point, it was just dy, okay, formerly. Okay, but now what we're saying is that, well, we can even solve ones where it's more interesting. A function of y dy equals a function of x dx. So the most general form of this, these are called separable differential equations. So, equations of this form. So dy dx is p of x divided by q of y. So when this is the case, then we can say dy is p of x over q of y dx, which is to say we get the differentials separated, and then we can get the variables separated by multiplying both sides by q of y, so that q of y dy is p of x dx. So what I'm telling you is that up to now, all that we had done was when q of y was 1. Q of y was 1 in all the cases that we dealt with up to now. So now we're going to start dealing with a case where it's like this. And then after we've gotten used to doing this separable case, we'll start doing differential equations which are not separable. Yay. Okay, so any question about this definition? Okay, so how about this one? So for example, please solve dy dx is x squared plus 1 over xy. And then find the general, let's make it xy squared. Find the general solution. So what do you think we should do?
Multiply the whole equation by y squared.
Okay. So if we do that, it would be y squared dy is x squared plus 1 over x dx.
Yes.
If I do both of those.
Yes.
Okay, then what? We could, but even before that, there's something that we could do to make our lives a little easier. Yeah, we can simplify this fraction, right? Because y squared dy, we could write it as x squared over x plus 1 over x dx.
Wait, can we not simplify?
We can, but I just wanted to do baby steps, right? And then x squared over x is x. Okay, so now that it's simplified, okay, now let's start taking antiderivatives. So antiderivative y squared dy is antiderivative x plus 1 over x dx. Okay, and now all of these terms we can anti-differentiate. So antiderivative of y squared dy?
Y to the third derivative.
Very good. Antiderivative x dx?
X squared derivative.
Very good. And then antiderivative 1 over x.
Log of x.
Almost.
Oh,
log of absolute value of x.
Log of absolute value of x.
Oh, so close.
And then plus c. And then, I didn't do it on this exercise, but I could have said, given that some xy value is a solution. And then you'd have to plug that in and figure out what c is. Okay, so any question about this one? Okay, so now, for the next several minutes, we're going to worry about some particular historically important differential equations that were solved. Okay? So, did you know that bunnies, you know, the little creatures, okay, there used to not be any bunnies in Australia. Okay, there used to not be any. But they were introduced into Australia.
There's still not any squirrels,
right? Are there no squirrels? Well,
sorry.
I believe it. Okay, but at any rate, there were no bunnies in Australia, and they were introduced. And now there's bunnies everywhere in Australia. Okay, getting eaten up by all the fantastic other creatures that are in Australia. But there's bunnies everywhere. So the way populations grow, at least in the beginning, is that the rate at which they grow is proportional to the current size of the population, which means that, for example, there's 7 billion human beings on the planet currently. A little more than that, but it's around 7 billion. So the yearly change in population of the Earth is something like 100 million. That means that there's 100 million new people every year. That's a lot of new people. Okay, but believe it or not, human beings, in comparison to other species anyway, actually grow pretty slowly. Our populations grow pretty slowly, because if there were 7 billion, sorry, yeah, because it just has to do with the strategy, right? So typically, so humans are called K strategists, which means that we have very few offspring but take very good care of them. Different types of creatures have different strategies. For example, you know, like aphids, the bug creatures that eat plants, their strategy is just have as many offspring as possible and don't take any care of them. So that's what they do. Okay, and then different creatures have different strategies. So your population grows in proportion to the current size of the population. Okay. So This is called the proportional model. So suppose that the population P grows in proportion K to its current size. I'm having trouble writing today. Yeah. So, dp dt. So, what does dp dt represent? Nearly. The rate of change of population with respect to time. Okay, is Kp. So that's what that means. The rate of change is proportional to the current size. So if the current size is big, the rate of change is big. If the current size is small, the rate of change is small. Yeah, that makes sense, because at the beginning, when there were just two bunnies in Australia, right? The population was growing slowly-ish. But by the time there was 1 million bunnies in Australia, now we're really talking, right? Bunnies all the time, right? Okay. So, let's determine what P is. So, solve for P. By the way, so I'm not really going to get that into it, but for growth, since we're talking about growth, this is saying that K is positive. But in the other case is that you could have decay when K is negative. So the go-to example for decay is something like radioactive decay, which is to say that if you had an enormous lump of radioactive uranium, then the amount of decay that you would observe would be big when you have a lot of uranium. And then as you get less and less uranium as a result of it decaying, the decay rate slows down further and further.
Good question. So is your decay table an R or a K?
That's a K. Now you can make it R. Doesn't matter. Okay, so then how are we going to solve for P?
By the game, multiply times dp.
Okay, good. So I'll do one of those at a time. So Kp dt. So in the end, what are we trying to do? What variables are there? P and T. Are the variables separated currently? No, right? They're not separated. So the left-hand side has just P's. That's good. What does the right-hand side have?
P's
and T's. That's not good. So how do we fix that?
Divide by P.
Divide by P. Okay. So then 1 over P dP is K dT. Are the variables separated?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, because K is just a constant. Okay, so then let's anti-differentiate. So antiderivative 1 over P dP is antiderivative K dT. Okay, how about the left-hand side?
Divide
What is it?
Log P.
Log absolute P.
Well, P is population, right? So would the absolute be necessary?
Very good. So no. But I'll remark that in a moment. So how about antiderivative of K dt?
Zero.
No, that'd be derivative of K dt.
K squared over 2.
No, K is a constant.
Yeah. Oh, KT.
KT. And then plus some constant. Okay, and then yes, as remarked, because P represents a population, it cannot be negative. So we can drop the absolute value.
So K is a constant?
K is a constant. Okay, so we want to solve for P. Have we solved for P yet?
No.
No, we haven't solved for P.
We need to times it times.
How do we solve for P?
Times it times E.
Exponential, right? So P is exponential kt plus c. Okay, so now I'm going to use the laws of exponents. Say that's exponential e to kt multiplied by exponential c. Okay, now, what is c? What does it represent in this procedure? It's just some arbitrary constant, right? And it could be positive or negative or zero. We don't know what it is. How about exponential of C? It's still arbitrary, but now it can't be anything. What is exponential of C?
Greater than zero.
Right? Because C could be anything, but exponential of C has to be positive, because the exponential of positive things is positive. The exponential of 0 is 1, which is positive, and the exponential of negative things is still positive. So what e to c represents, it represents an arbitrary positive constant.
What?
Because m equal to e to c is arbitrary positive constant. So this is the solution.
Where did that m come from?
So instead of writing e to c, I wrote m.
Can I put l?
Yeah, l would be fine.
Okay.
You just can't use p or T, or any of the other letters that we were already using. Okay, so then now, what this looks like, if you were to draw it, so this is, so m is some positive constant, and k, because we're talking about growth, is also some positive constant. So this is a growing exponential. So it would look something like this. And it grows quite rapidly. Right? So now, historically, this was the cause of great concern. A cause of great concern, because one of the first times when this was really publicly discussed was by an ecologist called Malthus. So you may have heard of Malthus. And if nothing else, you may have heard of something called a Malthusian catastrophe, which is where it's the doomsday scenario where you say, oh, well, there's so many human beings, eventually we're going to run out of food or air or, you know, whatever. We're going to run out. Okay, so then there was a, you know, at the time, a lot of public concern, like, oh no, scientists have figured out that we're all going to die, you know, the sky's falling. Okay, in the end, it's sort of silly to think about, right? Because the concern was about human beings. But if Malthus was right, then the same thing would have already happened to, say, crickets, okay? Right? Oh no, the crickets are gonna take over, you know, with their because they don't have the same reproductive strategy as we do, right? We have just a few children that we take a lot of care of. Crickets, they just cricket everything. Okay, so you know, just that alone should have been enough to make people be less concerned about a Malthusian catastrophe. So that's still a thing. There's still plenty of people who currently think we're on the way to a Malthusian catastrophe. So that model is not realistic, okay? Because going back to the Australia model, right? When you just put two bunnies in Australia, and then they start doing their thing, and then there's more bunnies. So the population of bunnies grows quite rapidly. But did it grow without bound? No, obviously, right? Because if it did, then the whole solar system would just be populated with bunnies by now. So what really happens is that there's a certain level, a certain quantity of bunnies that Australia can sustain. Okay, I don't know what the number is, but I'll just make one up. Maybe it's 10 million bunnies. That's how many bunnies can be in Australia. Okay, so now we're going to deal with a model that does that. Okay, it's a slight improvement upon, or a slight different take upon the previous model. So this is the deviation from target model. Deviation So suppose a population P grows in proportion K to its deviation from target size N. Okay. So what's the model going to be? So it starts out looking... Oh, not quite. We're not there yet. So it starts out looking, so I haven't finished writing, it starts out looking quite similar to the proportional model. Okay, but it doesn't grow in proportion to the population size. It grows in proportion to the deviation from the target size. So this will be N minus P. So let's try and think about what this model is saying. So what if we're talking about bunnies? And N is 10 million. N is 10 million. What if there's less than 10 million bunnies in Australia? What would we expect from the population? It would grow, right? It should grow until it reaches that target, right? Or what if we were at the target and then someone airlifted in a few millions of bunnies? then what would we expect? Yeah, we would expect the population to decrease to the target value. Okay, let's see why that's what this differential equation is saying. So dp/dt, that's how p changes in time. That's how p changes in time. And if we plot what happens according to certain p values, you can see that there's a critical place, a critical change that occurs at p is n. So if p is less than n, if p is less than n, what do we say is going to happen? It's going to go up. So if p is less than n, k is positive. And if p is less than n, how about n minus p? If p is smaller than n. This, it'll be positive, right? So it would be like saying 10 million is the right number of bunnies, but currently we have 8 million. Okay, so this would be positive. So the resulting product is positive. So we would expect the population to increase. Now what if we have too many bunnies, right? P is bigger than N. Then how about, what is the SIGN of this?
Negative.
So the overall SIGN in that region is negative, so we would expect the population to decrease. So that's the manner in which this model is describing its target-seeking behavior. So now, another example, a physical model where this occurs, is in the temperature of various objects. So if the temperature in this room was, say, 70 degrees, and the HVAC equipment was keeping it at a constant 70. And then we brought in another object that was, say, 30 degrees. What would we expect of the object that's at 30 degrees? Its temperature will increase to where?
70.
To 70, eventually. Or what if we brought in an object that was 100 degrees? Then what we would expect? The temperature of the object would decrease to 70. So now here's the trick of it is that how fast does the object of a temperature change in such a scenario? So which is to say, if we had 70 degree room and in it we had a 10 degree object and another one that was 50 degrees, which one would be changing its temperature faster?
Change it faster the further it is away from the temperature and then slow down the closer it gets.
Yes. The amount of what it is that the rate at which temperature changes that energy transfers is proportional to the deviation. So if you're in a room that's being held at a constant 70 degrees and you have two objects, whichever one is further away in temperature will be the one whose temperature is changing the fastest, assuming all of the things are equal. So just like this. So let's solve for P now. Okay, so how will we do it? No. Remember, k and n are constant. So they're not variables. What are the variables in the model?
P and T.
P and T. K and n are constants. So dp is k, n minus p. dt. And so how do we fix this? Variables are not separated.
Divide the whole thing by n minus p.
Yes. 1 over n minus p dp is k dt. Okay, so do you observe now the variables are separated? Okay, so what now?
Anti-differentiate.
Okay, so the right-hand side is easy. It's the same as before. So that's e to kt. No, that's just kt. What am I talking about? Brain. Kt. Okay, so then as for the left-hand side, what do we need to do? A u substitution. Okay, what u? Okay, so u is n minus p. Then what's du? No? What's the derivative of n minus p with respect to p? What's the derivative of n with respect to p?
Zero,
because n is a constant. What's the derivative of negative p?
Negative 1.
Negative 1. So negative dp. So if you like, you could write du divided by negative 1 is dp. So that would be saying antiderivative 1 over u du divided by negative 1 is kt. And now that antiderivative in the bottom left, is that an antiderivative that you recognize? Yes. So that would be what? Negative log absolute value of u, but u is n minus p, is kt, and now I have to write a plus c. And I could have written it on the left-hand side, but I'm going to write it on the right-hand side. It doesn't matter where you write it. Okay, now, on the previous model that we were considering, we dropped the absolute value because we observed that the population has to be non-negative. Can we drop the absolute value here? No, we cannot. Why can we not drop the absolute value? Because the deviation could be negative, right? For the deviation to be negative, that means that you have more than what you're supposed to have, right? Too many bunnies. Then the rate is going to be negative. Okay, so let's solve for p now. Let's solve for p. Okay. So first step, log absolute n minus p is negative kt minus c. Then how do we get rid of that log? Exponential. So absolute n minus p is exponential negative kt multiplied by exponential negative c. Okay, so now that means that there's two possibilities. There's several things that are going to happen all run together. So we've got to keep track of all the possibilities. So C, that's an arbitrary constant. How about negative C? It's still an arbitrary constant, right? It's still arbitrary because, you know, it could be anything, right? If you wanted negative C to be 50, all that would be required would be C is negative 50. Okay, how about e to negative c? What kind of thing is that? It exists.
Or it's a positive number.
It's an arbitrary but positive number. Okay, so C is arbitrary anything. Exponential of negative C is arbitrary positive. Arbitrary positive. So dropping the absolute value, that'd be n minus p is plus or minus e to negative kt e to negative c. So n minus p is, I'll write it like this, plus or minus e to negative c e to negative kt. Okay, now let's try and understand what this is. So C is an arbitrary constant. Okay, C is arbitrary. Exponential of negative C is arbitrary positive. But then now plus or minus exponential of negative C is now again arbitrary, right? Okay, this, so what this altogether, what this thing in parentheses is saying, this is some arbitrary number. Okay? So I'm going to just rewrite that as an M. So this is some arbitrary number. Now we can solve for P. So we can solve for P in a variety of ways. We can move the P over here and the M term to the other side. And doing that, that would be P is N minus M e to negative KT. And now we need to figure out, so what is M? What is M? So how do we figure out what M is? So we'll skip that step. We'll come back to it anyway. So let's try and imagine, what is this saying? What is this saying? So we have N, that's a constant. How about, what is this term doing? What is this, e to negative kt? Sorry? The growth portion. And because k is going to be a positive constant, then what is this doing? This is decaying, right? This is decaying. So that means that this term is decaying, because m times a decaying term is decaying, because m is just constant. And so this term right here is going to zero. It's going to zero. So the deviation from n, the target population, is going to go to zero as time increases. So as time increases, this term goes to zero. So if you were to plot this, it would look like the following. If you started out with too many bunnies, then they'd die off quite rapidly until they approach this value. If you started out with too much but less bunnies, then they'd still die off, but a little more slowly, etc., going down and down and down. Now, if you started out with not enough bunnies, what would happen? They would increase. And the less bunnies that you have, the faster they would increase at the beginning anyway, at least according to this model. And the more bunnies you have, the slower they would increase. Okay, over time. So now, there's something about this model that is very unrealistic. So what's unrealistic about this model? It's not n. The n can be made somewhat realistic because just take Australia. It's a landlocked region, and bunnies they're not notable flyers or swimmers, so they can't really escape Australia. So there is some n value, the number of bunnies that Australia can support. So that's reasonable. That part's reasonable. But there's something that's entirely unreasonable about this model. And that has to do with this right here.
The less, the faster?
Yeah. The less bunnies there are, the faster they'll population will increase. No, that's not right. That's not right. Because, if you have two bunnies, okay, at the end of, say, 6 months, then you probably have like five bunnies or something like that, okay? And then, so it's increasing. But if you had 2 million bunnies, then at the end of 6 months, you'd have 5 million bunnies. That's going up a lot faster, right? Okay, so that this is entirely unreasonable. Okay, that's not the way population actually occurs. This is the way temperature transfers. Temperature does transfer in proportion to the deviation from whatever the surrounding temperature is. Okay, but this is not reasonable for bunnies. Okay. So now one more iteration on this model will give us a new model that's starting to be quite accurate as far as population modeling is concerned. It's called the logistic model. So whoever said S-curve, that's what we're talking about now. So there's two things, the two previous models. They both capture something about population and growth that's important. Okay, and the way things actually go is that, if we could somehow evacuate Australia of all bunnies and then redo that experiment again, then what you'd observe is that you put in the initial population of bunnies, the population of bunnies would grow approximately exponentially. They would grow quite fast. But then the bunnies would start, after there's so many bunnies, they would start competing with each other over space and food and everything else. And then the amount, the rate at which the bunnies can grow starts slowing down to a target value. And in population ecology, this is called the carrying capacity. So Australia has just a certain number of bunnies it can support, and that's it, because there's only so much Australia, right? Eventually they're all going to be shoulder to shoulder. You can't get any more bunnies in there. So what we need is we need both of the properties of the previous two models. So suppose that we have a population. Grows in proportion over n to the current population and to the current deviation. Deviation from the target n. So this model starts out in quite similar fashion. So k over n, so in proportion. And then now how do we finish up the rest?
N minus p.
Okay, n minus p is one of them. So that'd be in proportion to the deviation. And what else? So no. So this model is almost the same as the previous one, except the division by n. So it has to be in proportion to the current population and also the current deviation. So we need another p. So now it'll be in proportion to both. It's in proportion to the population, and it's in proportion to the current deviation. So that is to say, in proportion to the current population, and in proportion to the current deviation. So it's in proportion to them both. Okay, now, k and n are positive. And p, because it's a population, it's positive. So how about n minus p? Is it positive? It can be, right? It depends. So this model has the same behavior that we observed in the previous one. Which is to say that when the population is below n, below the carrying capacity, the target value, if you like, then the population will increase. And if it is above n, the carrying capacity, the target value, then the population will decrease. So it still has that same property. However, observe further that when p is much smaller than n. So that is to say, like in our thought experiment where we've said, okay, we have just now put the first two bunnies in Australia. And that's two is much less than the number of bunnies that Australia can support. Okay? So in that case, we'll take this division by n, and I'll move it to be with the deviation term. So that would be k, and then n minus p over n, multiplied by p. And now I'm going to simplify this fraction, n minus p over n. So how can I simplify it?
1 minus p over n.
Very good. And now, because p is much smaller than n, that means that this term right here is close to what? close to zero. Which means that this term, or this factor, is close to what? So if this is close to zero, then 1 minus that is close to what?
One.
Close to 1. Which means that approximately dp dt is behaving like kp. And what is kp? What is this model? That's the first model we did, right? That was 2 pages ago. This is the proportional model. And the result is exponential. And that is what you actually observe. If you put 2 bunnies in Australia, and those were the only 2 bunnies, then their population would start growing, and it would appear to be growing exponentially. Okay, now, when P is approximately N, that is to say, when you're starting to get to the target size, when you're starting to get to the target size, now I'll take this N, I'll take that N and combine it with the red P to get that dP dt is K N minus P P over N. So now, if P is approximately N, then what is this? This is approximately 1. That term's approximately 1. So that dP dt is approximately K multiplied by N minus P. But what is this? This is the deviation model, right? So what this is saying is that depending on how big P is in comparison to N, then this behaves some of the time like the exponential model, the exponential growth model, and some of the time like the deviation model, okay? And if you were to plot the solutions to these, then you would observe the following. So, if you started out with just 2 bunnies in Australia, okay, then the population would grow slowly at first, and then exponential, and then they'd start getting too close and be shoulder to shoulder, and it would level off. An S curve. And this should be smooth. That's just me picking up my pen. Okay, so then, like so. If you started off with, say, you know, you airlifted in 100,000 bunnies, okay, then the population would grow and then level off. If you airlifted in 10 million bunnies, then it would just barely grow. Okay, now if you airlifted in 1 billion bunnies, first off, how did you do that? And second, right, the number of bunnies that exist would die off until it reaches the carrying capacity. So this curve right here, this S curve, is called a logistic curve. And this actually is a fairly good approximation, when all of the things are held fixed, of how a population grows. So if you could completely depopulate Australia of bunnies, and then put exactly 2 bunnies in Australia, then this is approximately how the population would go. It would grow slowly, and then start growing quite rapidly until they start competing with each other, and then it would level off to the carrying the bunny carrying capacity of Australia. Okay, now, as for this one, the previous two models we solved for P. We solved for P, but this one is slightly more complicated, so I'm gonna omit solving it for P. But what's important, and what I want you to take away from this study, is the following, is that here's three models, three differential equation models. This is the first one. So when growth is in proportion to current size, the result is exponential. Things that are like this are bunnies in Australia, or your bank account. Okay? It really is, because if you put money into your bank account, then the amount of interest that you accrue is proportional to the amount of size, the amount of money that was in your bank account.
As long as you keep money in the bank.
As long as you have a positive balance. Okay? So the amount of interest that you get is proportional to your average account balance, which is to say that if you've got $100 over the month, okay, you're going to get like, 3 cents or whatever, maybe, if you're lucky, okay, deposited into your account. But if you're Bill Gates and, you've got your $60 billion bank account, okay, the monthly interest payments that the bank would make to such an account exceeds probably all of our yearly incomes combined, right? The amount of interest gained is in proportion to the account balance and to the size of the money. Okay, same thing with rabbits, right? If there are two rabbits, okay, at the end of 6 months, it would not be surprising to have five rabbits. If there were 2 million rabbits at the end of 5 months, it wouldn't be so surprising to have 5 million rabbits, because the rate at which the rabbits are increasing is proportional to the current population. Now, that's unrealistic to think that that's going to indicate a catastrophe, right? Because that's not the way it actually works. So now this is more realistic, that growth is proportional to deviation from some target value, okay? But this model is unrealistic in the sense that the further you are away from the target value, the faster the population changes. So this is accurate for temperatures, but it's not accurate for bunnies. And this one is accurate for bunnies. Okay, it's also accurate for things like certain other chemical reactions. I'm having difficulty pulling one out of my brain here.
New industries that are prone to a lot of growth would see are similar to this.
Yes.
So the return on each dollar from ideas being less common to come by is lower.
Right. So you've got a new idea, and it takes a while for the populace to uptake on it.
Pokemon Go.
Yeah. Okay. There you have it. Exactly. This is where we are in Pokemon Go, right here.
Okay.
But it has to reach a certain plateau, because there's only 7 billion people on the planet, right? It's
right
not
now.
Right now, okay, so. Good. Right, yeah. Yeah, since we've had this conversation, there's another million people. Okay. So any question about that? Okay. So let's have an example. What time do we get out? 45?
No, right now.
Yeah.
Whatever time it is right now, that's the time we get out.
I've lost focus.
You've lost focus? I never had focus. I was just, I've been zoned out the whole time.
Yeah, I don't understand. He's in a t-shirt.
Feels a lot better in here than it does outside.
Okay. Okay, so dy/dx, dy/dx is x cubed over y, and xy is 0.5 is a solution. So please solve. Yeah, we're regressing.
I was like, all of that, and now we're back to this.
Well, part of that, yeah, I mean, in the end, that was just an application of this.
Oh, okay.
Are we going to need to know that? What you did, like the S-curve and stuff on our quizzes?
Yes. I'll find a way to make sure it's on there.
You don't have to.
But, I mean... The design and study and solution to such differential equations is quite important in business and everything else to be able to model.
What are the points in the parentheses?
0.5. Okay. So, how do we solve? Right. So, y dy is x cubed dx. See, doesn't this seem easy now in comparison?
Yes, it does. And then we start overthinking stuff and we're like, well, it's
more
complicated than that.
Yes.
Okay, so then left-hand side, y squared over 2, right-hand side, x to 4 over 4. So you can write the plus c anywhere that you want, right? So you could write it on the left, you could write it on the right-hand side. I'm just going to write it on the right-hand side. Okay, so then now, is this the answer to the question? No, right? Because every time I ask that, the answer is no. So this into there now. So then that would be 25 over 2 is 0 plus c. So the answer to the question is... y squared over 2 is x to 4 over 4 plus 25 over 2. Any question about this one? No, you don't need to write that. But just remember that the more work you show, the clearer it is, the easier it is for the grader to understand what mistake that you made, right? So if you plugged in 0.5 into here and somehow like just some catastrophe of arithmetic occurred, then if it was bad enough, then the grader wouldn't be able to tell like what happened. Like, it would look like nonsense. Right? But if you wrote this, then the grader would at least be able to suspect, well, it looks like they tried to do that, but then something didn't work. Okay. Okay, so how about a word problem? So suppose that we have a profit P is being analyzed in terms of advertising dollars A. And suppose that the marginal profit is, so by the way, marginal, that's a business term. What does that mean? The derivative of P with respect to A. So the marginal profit with respect to advertising dollars is derivative of profit with respect to advertising dollars. So marginal profit is DPDA. And let's say that that's equal to 100 divided by 32 minus x, minus 4x. And that the profit at no advertising dollars is, say, 1,000. So find P. And that should be an A. What am I? Oh, it's been a long day. Wow. Where'd the X come from? For A. Okay, so what do we do?
Good question.
Yeah, so I'd like to impress upon you that this question is really no different whatsoever than all the other ones we've been doing. It's really just exactly the same. The only purpose of me putting this exercise in at all is really just to remind you that marginal means derivative.
So is this, so is the point, 0, 1,000?
Yes. So DP is 100 over 32 minus 4A DA. And then what? Antiderivative.
You pull the 100 out?
Yes, that would be fine. Okay, so how will we, so I went ahead and I did the one antiderivative, right? That one was, I did that one. So how about, as for the other one, how do we deal with that?
U sub.
Okay, so then U is 32 minus 4A. So then what's DU?
Negative 4 DA.
So that DU divided by negative 4 is DA. Okay, so making that substitution, that would be what? That'd be antiderivative, 100 divided by u, du divided by negative 4. Right, so 100 divided by negative 4 is negative 25.
Which, and it wasn't 100%, you could take it.
Right, so you could, yeah. And then what is antiderivative of 1 over u du?
Oh,
right, log absolute u, so 32 minus 4a plus a constant. And so, what now? Yeah, we plug in. So this is telling you that the point AP equal to 0, 1000 is a solution. So now we can plug those in. So 1000 is negative 25 and then log of 32. Plus C, so 1,000 plus 25 log 32 is C. So you could write down your answer as P is negative 25 log absolute 32 minus 4A. And then what?
Plus
1,000. Plus 1,000 plus 25 log
32.
And then if this was a money, since this was a money problem, I would say give it to me in the nearest cent or whatever. Then you wouldn't have to write 25 log 32. That's how I write my checks, right?
As a banker, I hate you.
No. Well, you can write whatever you want in the memo field, yes. Right?
You can write whatever you want in the number field too. It's just the writing.
Oh, I
the
see.
Written portion that has to be correct.
Okay.
I mean, I don't advise it, but.
Yeah. Okay. So one more, and then that'll be the last one. Okay, so how about x dy dx plus 6y plus 2x to 4 is equal to 0. And I want you to find the general solution. Which means get up to the plus C and then don't worry about it. This one has a big trick in it. Okay, so for those of you that are trying to solve it, what's the problem you're running into?
Everything.
Everything is wrong with this.
Can we separate half x dx from dy? Can we separate dy dx?
No. So all of the ones that we've done up to now, you've been able to more or less separate the variables. So there's no amount of playing around with these, adding, subtracting, and multiply and divide. There's no amount of that, no finite number of steps that you can take to separate these variables. Nevertheless, we need to know how to solve it. Okay, so what I need to do now is all that we're going to do is I'm going to foreshadow for you what we're going to do on Thursday. Okay, how to deal with this. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull a rabbit out of a hat. Okay, it's just from Australia. Ta-da! Okay, so so first thing is I want to get dy dx by itself. Okay, so I want to get dy dx by itself. So to do that, I'll divide by x. Dy dx plus 6y over x plus 2x cubed is 0. Okay, so now we have dy dx by itself. I divided everything by x. Now I'm going to get this term over here on the right-hand side. So I'll have dy dx plus 6y over x is negative 2x cubed. So all of this is, it's not clear why I'm doing this at all, but now here's the most unclear thing, is that I'm going to, for some reason, I'm going to take this dy dx plus 6y over x equal to negative 2x cubed, and I'm going to multiply both sides by x to 6. Okay, I agree that y is a good question. This is the rabbit. This is the rabbit coming out of the hat. Okay, so now, that's in Australia, right?
I've seen some other things you've drawn this class. You could have done that.
I could have done that better. I can only draw utilitarian things. Abstract things I can't do. Okay, so then x to 6 dy dx plus, now if I multiply x to 6 by this, then how does it simplify? Okay, x to 5 6y is negative 2. And then x to what? X to 9. And now I'm going to make one small change here. So I'll leave this the same. And now I'm going to rewrite this term just slightly and say plus 6x to 5y is negative 2 x to 9. Okay, now, the left-hand side is where all of the action is. So what does the left-hand side look to you like? Look like to you?
A problem.
Not quite. So it looks to me like the left-hand side is the result of something, like something occurred on the left-hand side. Let's think about it. So if you came by, right, this is like being in a crime scene investigator, right? You weren't there, okay, for it. All that you see are the clues of what happened.
Oh, it's the derivative of 6x to the 5th, right?
Now you're getting warmer.
I give up then.
You're getting warmer. Look, x to 6
is a derivative.
And its derivative.
Y
and its derivative. What is this? Not partial. Look, you have something that looks like u dv plus du v.
Oh, it's by parts?
This is not by parts. It's, well, sort of. This is the product rule. This is the product rule. So look, the left-hand side can be written as d dx, x to 6, y is negative 2, x to 9. Right? Because what's the derivative of x to 6, y, assuming y is a function of x? 6x to 5 times y.
Oh.
Plus x to 6 dy dx.
It's too much. I don't like this rabbit. Put him back in that.
Put him back. Okay, now d x to 6 y is negative 2 x to 9 dx. And so now we have performed a separation. We weren't able to separate the variables, but we were able to perform this separation. So now we have d of the stuff inside here is negative 2 x to 9 dx. So how can we get rid of the d's?
By doing the derivative.
Antiderivative. Antiderivative d. X to 6 y is negative, is antiderivative. Negative 2 x to 9 dx. And so what is antiderivative of dx to 6 y? 6
x y. No.
Just x to 6y. So
that's what I meant.
Antiderivative and d, they just interact and cancel. Okay, and then what is the antiderivative of this?
Negative 1/5 x to the 10.
Very good.
Plus c.
And then now, even better, if we were so inclined, we could solve for y. Mm-hmm. And get... what? If we divide by x to 6, that'd be x to 4. Plus c over x to 4.
Oh, x to 6.
Thank you.
Yeah. That's a lot.
And so, now the real question is where did that x to 6 come from?
Yeah, that is a good question.
So the way it's in the end, what the purpose of that x to 6 is, the purpose of the x to 6 was so that we could get here, so that we could reckon the left hand side as being as the result of the product rule.
So we times and times.
I have no idea how you get there.
Okay, so I'm just so. What I want you to see is that, notice what the x to the 6 did. It enabled us to do this step right here, to say that we have this, which is the result of the product rule. This is where we wanted to get. X to 6 is how we got there. The question is where did I come up with x to 6?
Great question.
And that's what we're going to talk about next time.
Oh.
Come on.
Okay, so have a nice Tuesday.